Okay, good morning, everybody. Welcome to the Atlantic Council. I'm André Montanino, the Bowdoin Gray Fellow and Director of the Atlantic Council Global Business and Economics Program. If you want to participate via Twitter, use the hashtag EUGrowth, EU like European Union. The event is in fact part of our Eurogrowth initiative, where we are trying to provide a blueprint on how to restore sustainable and inclusive growth across Europe as a response to populism concern. We in fact believe that member states should make their homework and continue to deliver reforms to make their economies more competitive, but it's not sufficient. European institutions also must provide concrete deliverables so that European citizens can value the benefit of being part of the Union. And the European Stability Mechanism is one of these institutions. It managed to provide financial assistance and expertise to avoid disruptive events. And despite citizens, at least in countries backed by financial assistance, tend to dislike the institution, I think, maybe Klaus have a different view, it is instead a clear case on what the EU can do to support its citizens beyond what a single member state can do. So from today's discussion, I hope to get an update about the progress of the five Eurozone countries, Cyprus, Greece, Ireland, Portugal, and Spain, that have received financial assistance, and the overall health of the Eurozone ahead of this week's crucial elections in France. But I would like also to look at the future. What are the lessons learned from the ESM experience helping the Eurozone to successfully navigate the severe debt crisis? Could the ESM serve as a model for other regional financial institutions around the world? And to develop this thought a little further, what are some of the concrete steps the ESM is currently taking in cooperation with the IMF to improve coordination among regional financial institutions to make the global financial system more stable and less risk-prone? And to get back to Europe, is it conceivable that the ESM could expand its current mandate to issue true Eurobonds at some point in the future and basically function as a Euro treasury? So there are many questions, and the ESM will be facing a lot of challenges going forward. And that's why I'm so pleased to introduce today's keynote speaker, Klaus Regling. Klaus currently serves as ESM First Managing Director. He worked for many years as an economist in senior positions in the public and the private sector in Europe, Asia, United States, including the IMF and the German Ministry of Finance. From 2001 to 2008 or 2010, Klaus was Director General for Economic and Financial Affairs of the European Commission. And as a personal note, I spent 4 years in DG ECFIN when Klaus was Director General, and I was just a young economist, and I remember his calm and determination to move forward proposals to make the Stability and Growth Pact less stupid, as the President of the Commission said at that time. Before I hand over the mic to Klaus, I would also like to introduce Gina Smilek, economic reporter at Bloomberg News, that will moderate the Q&A that will follow right after Klaus' keynote remarks. So without further ado, I would like to welcome Klaus to the stage. Thank you.
Thank you, Andrea, for your warm welcome. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. It's a pleasure to be here, also to see some good old friends. Good to be in Washington during this week. Of course, there's a lot of competition. There are many other events going on at the same time, so I appreciate you are here. So I will speak for 10-12 minutes, therefore I will not be able to answer all the questions you raised, but luckily we have 4 hours, right, so we can go through that. So I will speak a bit and then happy to answer questions. The financial crisis began almost 10 years ago, as you remember, so I think it's a good moment to take stock of where Europe has moved, what has been Europe's response to the crisis, although it's always important to remember that Europe was hit by two crises, There was the subprime crisis triggered in the US that swept around the world and affected also Europe, of course. But then we had our second homegrown euro crisis 2 years later. So that was the second crisis. And that's one reason why it took us a while to get out of all of this, hit by two serious crises within a short period of time is not easy. The European Stability Mechanism originated in that crisis. So I will say a few words on what we have been doing the last few years. I will also take a quick look at the European economy, which I think now it's getting clearer that we are doing a bit better than people thought. The IMF has revised upward growth forecasts for Europe, like for other continents. And I will also point out some of the underlying strengths that help us in Europe to contain the rising skepticism towards globalization and international trade. Finally, I want to put the ESM in a broader context, as you also suggested. We are obviously the crisis resolution mechanism of the euro area, but we work together with other regional firewalls, and of course we work closely with the IMF. And these institutions, IMF, regional financial arrangements together, are two crucial layers of the global financial safety net, so I will say a word on that. But let me start with the ESM. The ESM is a lender of last resort for sovereigns. This is a function that did not exist in the initial design of monetary union. When monetary union was prepared, the founding fathers could not imagine that a country after joining the euro area could lose market access. Was unimaginable. I also could not imagine that. But we learned in the crisis that it can happen. So the EFSF, which was a predecessor of the ESM, was set up in 2010 as a temporary institution. And then the ESM came as a permanent international institution in 2012. Our offices and all the staff are in Luxembourg. And I will put now EFSF and ESM together when I give you some numbers. So there are two institutions behind it, but the mandate is the same, the instruments are the same, the setup is different. The total lending capacity of these two institutions is 700 billion euro. So that's almost as much as the IMF has globally available. We have disbursed 265 billion euro so far during the last 6 years. And the commitment, if we had the current third Greek program, is 320 billion euro. So there are 380 billion euro left uncommitted, as it should be for firewall. We need firepower in case something happens. We don't want it to happen, but it's available and we can, unlike what I read sometimes, even help large economies in the euro area. Unlike the IMF, which refinances itself through central banks, we fund ourselves in the market by issuing bonds and bills. So that is one of our main activities, actually. So before we can give any loan, we have to find some money in the market. And we do that since 2011. Our funding costs are low because we have AAA or AA plus rating from the rating agencies based on a very high capital. We have a capital of 700 billion euro subscribed by our member states. The 19 members of the euro area. And out of these 700 billion euro, 80 billion are paid in. So we have it in cash in our accounts. We invest it, another difficult task these days, with a low interest or negative interest environment. But that gives us strength. And that's why we have good rating and have low funding cost. And these low funding costs we pass on to countries that borrow from us. We had a very small fee because the amounts are big, so we don't need to add much to cover our operating cost. And with this approach, just charging our funding cost, ESM at the moment around 1%, we help, of course, the countries a lot. The IMF, for instance, charges Greece 5%, we charge 1%. So that's one big difference. And over time, this is a significant difference. Because Greece has received so much money from us, we have now half the Greek public debt in our books at 1%. So Greece saves in its budget every year 10 billion euro. That's 6% of Greek GDP. That's the biggest support program in world history. So when people say, when is there finally debt relief for Greece, they have not looked at the numbers. It's 6% in a gift every year. These are real savings. And you can also see it by looking at the remaining debt service from Greece, from the Greek budget. It's only 3% of GDP, which is lower than France, Belgium, Germany, and the US. So there's a real help here going on, real solidarity from other European countries to Greece and the other countries, but to a smaller extent. And this is crucial to make Greece debt burden sustainable again. ESM loans, like IMF loans, are granted only with conditionality. This is the approach we did not invent at all. We copied it from the IMF because we know it works. So a country can only receive an ESM loan if they agree to a reform package. The approach works not only for IMF countries outside Europe, it also works inside Europe. Four of the five countries that have received loans from us, Ireland, Spain, Portugal, and Cyprus, exited their programs successfully during the last 2 years. They are back in the markets, they can refinance themselves, they have the highest growth rates in Europe, unemployment is coming down rapidly. In Ireland, it's already below pre-crisis levels. So the approach is working. Greece is a very special case, and I can say a few words about that later. It is true that Europe's response to the crisis could have been swifter. That's often criticized in the markets by academics that we are too slow. And it's probably true. If we had been faster, it would have been better, probably could have saved money. But one has to understand that the 19 member states of the euro area are sovereign countries. They have pooled among themselves only a small part of sovereignty. Basically, they gave up monetary policy and the exchange rate instrument. But most of the policy areas are not pooled. They are still in the national competence. And of course, there are rules, particularly on the fiscal side, which is important when countries want to form a monetary union. So it's not surprising that 19 mainly independent countries cannot very quickly come to conclusions when there's a new problem, particularly if it costs money, because there has to be a national debate with the parliament, with public opinion, the media. Then there have to be long meetings in Brussels on Saturday and Sunday nights to bring 19 different views together. It takes time. I think it's the price of democracy, and one should have no illusion that this could disappear all of a sudden. It will not disappear because the 19 countries are independent. It could be a bit better in the future because during the crisis, institutions were created, as I said, that did not exist before. So we don't need we need more weekends to create a new institution when the next crisis hits. The ESM is there. Also, other institutions were created in the context of banking union, the European supervisor, the Single Resolution Fund, Single Resolution Board, all that is in place. It would help in the future. So that will speed up things a bit. But otherwise, we are not one country. We are not the United States of Europe. Overall, the European economy is doing well. And not only in 2017. 2017 is the fifth year of positive growth in Europe. Sometimes people are surprised by that. Growth has been above potential growth now for 3 years already. So the output gap is closing. Unemployment is coming down. Of course, the potential output growth in euro area, the EU, seems slow compared to the US. But in per capita terms, it's the same as in the United States, which has been a long-run relationship before the crisis hit. When you take out the differences in population growth, GDP per capita growth in Europe and the US is actually identical to the decimal point. And of course, policymakers have to look at GDP per capita growth because that determines how the standard of living is rising. And what is even more important is that these benefits from growth are spread much more equally in Europe than in the United States. In Europe, about 80% of the population has seen real income growth in the last 15 to 20 years, 80% in Europe, while in the US, that was the case for only 10 to 20%. So whatever the growth rate on a per capita basis, they are identical. But when you look at where the growth goes, Europe has a much better income distribution. The Gini coefficient has always been lower in Europe than in the United States and in China. And unlike in the US and China, where it deteriorated further the last 10 years, in Europe it has remained relatively stable. And that's why I said in the beginning, we have an underlying strength that makes it easier to address concerns about globalization and trade, which are spreading also in Europe. But I think we have better responses to that because basically Europe has the best income distribution in the world. Another point that's not often recognized is that our labor market is in much better shape than people think. Typically, people look at the unemployment rate, which is almost twice what it is in the United States. But people should also look at the employment rate, which has been rising the last 15 years, while it has been falling in the United States. And that means in Europe, despite our high unemployment rate, higher than, let's say, in the year 2000, there are actually more people who have a job in percent of the population than 15 years ago. And again, that adds to social cohesion and makes life a bit easier. So after these advertisements for Europe, let me say a few words about the global financial safety net. As I mentioned, the IMF and the regional financial arrangements are important layers of this GFSN, Global Financial Safety Net. Foreign exchange reserves, central bank swaps are the other important layers. Last month, the G20 finance ministers and central bank governors reiterated their commitment to strengthen this GFSN. It's an ongoing topic on the G20 agenda. And they want that there's improved cooperation between the IMF and these RFAs. The ESM in Europe is the biggest of these regional arrangements, but there are others in the Middle East, Latin America, East Asia, and Central Asia. And some of them are quite old. FLA in Latin America exists already for more than 35 years. Most people don't know it. They are small. The lending is the amounts are small, but it has been going on for 35 years, so it's an interesting observation. In the Middle East, there's the Arab Monetary Fund, which is, in a way, a combination of World Bank activities and IMF activities. So they're all different. But they all cooperate one way or another with the IMF. And that is important because they can complement the IMF activities because these RFAs have some advantages, particularly in a currency union. What are these advantages? First, the regional arrangements have an in-depth knowledge of the regional economies because they are very close. Second, the RFAs can potentially mobilize much more money than the IMF. And in a particular currency area, a lot of money is needed when a country loses market access because a country that uses the currency of its neighbors and a wider region is much more interconnected than other countries. So when they lose market access, they need a lot of money to replace that the lack of market access. So in the euro area, the IMF alone could simply not have met the financing needs of Greece, Portugal, Ireland, or Cyprus, would not have been compatible with the IMF access rules and the available amount of money. The third advantage is that RFAs can provide specific tools to address regional problems. For instance, the IMF could not participate in our lending to Spain because it restructured the Spanish banking system. And the IMF doesn't do sectoral lending. That's why they were only observers and advisors, but not lenders in that operation. And finally, the RFAs can be much more flexible with their lending terms. I already mentioned that our lending rates are very low based on our funding cost, so about a third of what the IMF charges. And our loans have very long maturities potentially. For Ireland and Portugal, it's 20 years. For Greece, it's 32 years, while the IMF typically has a 10-year horizon. We can also provide grace periods before any debt service payments are due. And therefore, our lending to Greece in particular, but also to other countries, contributes to debt sustainability. And I think this makes the ESM in the euro area better equipped to deal with the crisis than the IMF alone could have done, particularly on the debt side. And this is where we have had some debates in the last few months. Sorry, I need some water here. As I said, the IMF has this 10-year horizon. We have a much longer time horizon. And the IMF needs financing assurances that it will get its money back at the end of the program, of their program, the end of the disbursement, while we have more flexibility how to deal with that. We can make commitments from finance ministers what has happened, but this is difficult to integrate into the IMF framework of analysis, so that creates some problems. But so far, we have always been able to solve them. I'm sure there will be some questions, so I stop with Greece here. But I think it's fair to say that the relationship between the IMF and those regional arrangements around the world are evolving. The IMF, of course, must remain at the center of the international monetary system. I would not want to see a world where different regions drift in different directions. That would not be healthy. I also hope that the IMF can join the third program for Greece very soon. And finally, on Greece, I'm confident that the country can return to the market and stand on its own feet again when the program ends next year. And as long as Greece continues to implement reforms, sorry, I spoke too much. It's a good reminder to come to an end. That may also help, thanks. So I think I've made my main points, and I'm looking forward to the discussion.
Well, thank you for those comments. I'm going to jump right into questions about Greece, since that was sort of your last point, pulling off of that.
I'm not surprised.
So first and foremost, you know, is Greek's debt currently sustainable? And if not, what needs to happen to get it there?
That's an easy question, but it's not easy to answer, because it always depends on your assumptions. As I made clear, we are dealing with a very long time horizon here. Based on our current lending arrangement, the last repayment from Greece to the ESM would happen in 2060. And a lot can happen by then. That makes our lending so different from the IMF. And so that's not a criticism of the IMF, it's just a different framework that we have created based on a lot of solidarity from euro area countries to some countries that lost market access. So assumptions are important. There can be no certainty. What is, for instance, the growth 10, 20, 30 years from now? And small variations in that growth assumption have a huge impact on the assessment of debt sustainability. So we are in the middle of that to come to an agreement with the IMF, but also between European Commission, ESM, and ECB. Not easy, but I'm optimistic we will manage to do that. There is, right now, no debt overhang in Greece, unlike what you read in many newspapers and academics, whatever they say, because we already provide so much debt relief. Also, the private sector gave a lot of debt relief in 2012. It was the biggest haircut in world history. They gave up more than 100 billion euro. And we reduced, in NPV terms, our claims by 40%. Not a nominal haircut, but in NPV terms, by lengthening maturities and lowering interest rates. So this is why, as I mentioned, Greece every year already benefits with 10 billion euro, 6% of Greek GDP. So that is a lot of debt relief. Now, how much more is needed? What will happen?
There's no clear answer at the moment, but it's on the agenda of the Eurogroup, so the finance ministers of the Euro area. We discuss it with the IMF, because we want to make Greek debt even sustainable in the long run. At the moment, there's really no problem, because the actual payments are very limited. But one day, of course, there will be repayments. We have agreed, we agreed some time ago with the IMF on a framework how to look at this. This was also a difficult process where in the end we converged that it's not enough to look at the debt to GDP ratio, but one should also look at the flow numbers, the annual debt service flows, which are low now, they will go up, and we have a framework developed how to capture all of that. The Euro area finance ministers gave a statement last year in May that they asked us at the ESM to implement immediately some short-term debt measures, which we are doing. That reduces already the debt to GDP ratio in 2060 by 20 percentage points. They also said in May last year that when the program ends in August next year, they would look with the IMF at so-called medium-term debt measures, if needed, and that's under discussion now. What does it mean? But it would be could be implemented if needed next year. And then thirdly, very important, they made a long-term commitment and said, in the long run, the euro area is prepared to give additional debt relief to Greece if needed. And I think that's very useful, because the uncertainty over a 30, 40-year time horizon is necessarily very high. And no minister wants to give too much debt relief now, not very popular at home. But also, if it's too little, not very good for Greece. And who knows what happens in Greece and its immediate neighborhood, which is a tricky geopolitical situation, how much debt relief they need over the years. So there is really a staggered approach, short-term measures happening now, medium-term measures possibly next year, and a long-term commitment to help, because Greece is part of the family. And that, I think, is often not well understood outside Europe.
Has Greece seen too much austerity? Does the economy there need more breathing room?
Sorry, what?
Has Greece seen too much austerity? Has the sort of clampdown been too tight there?
There has been, of course, tremendous austerity. That's true. And that's why these programs are not very popular, as Andrea mentioned. Normally, the IMF is criticized for austerity, now also Commission and ESM sometimes. But one has to put it in context. So first, the austerity was tremendous the last 6 years, because the fiscal deficit in 2009 was 15.6% of GDP. Last year, we will get the numbers probably tomorrow, there was a balanced budget, it seems. That's a tremendous improvement. So austerity sounds so negative, but one can also look at it positively, because there's really no need for additional fiscal adjustment given that. It's pretty strong what has happened, and very positive. It's never nice when such a fiscal adjustment has to happen, because it can only happen through cuts in expenditures and rise in revenue. And both happened, of course. It reduces the standard of living of the population. That's what they don't like. It's painful. But one also has to see that during the first decade of monetary union, from 1999 to 2009, Greece had the highest increase in income. It was much faster than productivity gains. That's why they lost competitiveness. That's why they had a tremendous current account deficit. And that's why they had a big fiscal deficit. So there had to be an adjustment. And one can argue whether this move from a deficit of 15% to zero should happen over 5 years or 7 years or 9 years. But it has to happen eventually. So I think in the process, Greece got a lot of money, a lot of solidarity at low interest rates, that it was the package.
Absolutely. Now, how quickly will the current review of the Greek bailout close? Do you think it'll be done by the May 22nd Eurogroup meeting?
So that is the next regular Eurogroup meeting, that's right. And we are working all the time, and many people who are involved are in Washington, so you can imagine they are also working here. So we are working behind the scenes to prepare these Eurogroup meetings. The mission from the four institutions, ESM, IMF, ECB, and Commission will go back to Athens next week on Monday, Tuesday. So it's possible, but the Eurogroup can also have ad hoc meeting at any moment. So this is an important issue. If the time is ripe, they can just meet and seal the deal or agree on the last open issues.
Right, absolutely. Now, you've also noted on record that Greece is not going to need the full 86 billion in euros that's available to it in emergency loans. Could that money be used to buy back IMF loans? Is that a possibility on the table?
It's a possibility. So indeed, this current program is up to 86 billion. So far, we have disbursed 32 billion euro, and there are 15 months to go. Based on everything we know at the moment, they do not need another 54 billion euro, partly because the need for bank recapitalization turned out to be much less than what we assumed when the program was put together. And in these, this announcement of the Eurogroup last year in May that I mentioned, when we looked at short-term, medium, and long-term debt measures, as a possibility, nothing is decided, but as a possibility, it's mentioned that unused ESM resources could be used to repay the IMF early, because that would help, again, Greek debt sustainability, replacing debt with the IMF at high interest rates with the low ESM debt. So that is a possibility. But again, it's mentioned, it's black on white there in that statement of the Eurogroup, but decisions of what actually will be done will not be taken before the end of the program.
Okay, absolutely. Now, obviously the other countries that the ESM has been involved with are sort of success stories. At what point in time do you think we'll be able to call Greece a success story? At what point, how far out in the future is that?
If they continue with their reform program, it could be soon, because one should not forget, it seems like a very long time. The crisis started in 2009 for Greece. Now we are 8 years later. But one should not forget that it went in two big waves. By 2014, Greece had the first year of positive growth. The first successes became visible, like in the other countries. Unemployment fell by 2 percentage points that year. Greece even issued bonds on two occasions in the year 2014. So this was easy to see for macroeconomists who look at these numbers. Growth, export growth was strong, competitiveness had returned, unemployment started to fall. But voters don't see that, at least not immediately, what economists see in the numbers. So we know there was an election in January 2015. There was a new government, Prime Minister Tsipras, and his finance minister, Varoufakis, tried to do something completely different. And that threw back the Greek economy tremendously. One can look at the IMF forecast for the Greek economy in December 2014, and they projected 2.7% growth for 2015, based on the assumption that everything continues. In the end, it was negative again, because the new government for 6 months moved in the wrong direction. And in the process, they almost were forced to leave the euro area until we had a summit in late June to that year. And then there were many Eurogroup meetings, even in August, where Europeans want to be on vacation. And in the end, we found a way, and the third current program for Greece began. So they had to start again from a lower level than would have been necessary. That's one reason why it takes so long. It also gives me confidence that if they continue on that way, like in 2014, one can see the positive results. Last year, actually, growth was better than expected, and 3/4 it was positive. The fiscal performance seems was a lot better than expected. So things are beginning to move. The adjustment is not over. I think on the fiscal side, most of it is done, if the numbers are confirmed for last year. We are now more dealing with structural issues, structural reforms, in order to raise the growth potential, which of course in the end is what the economy needs, and that will give more jobs and more income to the people. So the hard part for the population has been done, which is good. But if this continues, I have no doubt at all that Greece can also become a success story.
Okay, absolutely. Now moving over to Italy, there's been a lot of talk about ESM getting involved with Italian banks. Should Italy be coming to the ESM, and what could the ESM do for Italian banks if they would do that?
First, I think it's important to clarify what is the Italian banking problem. It's not a countrywide systemic problem.
Right.
The Italian banks, like most European banks today, are much stronger than they were at the beginning of the crisis in 2009 and 10. Capital ratios are very high. They are close to the US levels. There are problems, particularly with non-performing loans. Profitability is low. But there are no systemic banking problems anywhere in Europe, including not in Italy. There are a few banks that have problems in Italy. There are also a few banks in other countries that have problems. And we know the numbers quite well of what is needed from the stress test of the ECB, SSM, and this big Italian bank, Monte Paschi, and we know exactly the ESM. The SSM said they need around 6 billion in additional capital. So these numbers are well known. But these are isolated cases. So there's about a handful of banks in Italy that need to work on their problems. That's happening. We have a more complex system now in Europe than 5 years ago. How that can be done, because we have the banking union and with new institutions, but also with new bank recapitalization and resolution rules. And these are particularly strict on what we call state aid. So the provision of public money is made very difficult, because the idea is, and that's right, that normally taxpayers should not pay for problems in banks. It should be the shareholders and the creditors of the bank. That was less clear up to 2014. So in this new environment, the Italian banks, again, a handful, have to find solutions. That has to be negotiated with the supervisor, the SSM, with the competition authority, DG Competition, that's the commission, to stay within the agreed rules. That takes a while, but that's what they are doing. But again, it's not a systemic issue.
So because it's not systemic, the ESM shouldn't be involved?
And therefore, that's right, you asked about the ESM. So the ESM has two instruments that could, in theory, be used when there is a banking problem in one of our member states. The one instrument is what we did in Spain in 2012 to provide a loan to the government, but all the money is earmarked to restructure the banking system. So that worked quite well in Spain. There's no case like that where we need to restructure an entire system in Europe at the moment. Our second instrument that would allow us to take equity capital in one individual bank, we have never used it, that's the last resort, because the bail-in rules are so strict that under normal circumstances this is not really needed. So again, this is very unlikely to be used in the foreseeable future. But it's good to have instruments, even if we don't if we don't see the need for their use at the moment.
I guess that kind of gets at this idea of what is the future of the ESM? When you look 5 years down the road, where do you see the institution evolving? What do you think what changes, what capabilities are you guys going to take on as you progress? You're still quite young.
We are still quite young, that's right, but we have changed already tremendously, much more than I ever thought. When I started this job in Luxembourg in 2010, the idea was to build up a very small institution that would never be really used, where the existence alone would already calm down markets. So that was a little bit too optimistic. We had to expand. But we are doing already a lot more than I ever thought. We supported 5 countries. I gave you the numbers, dispersed 265 billion euro. Which also means we had to issue 265 billion in bonds. Actually, more, because the first bonds that we issued in 2011, 5-year bonds, are maturing, so we have to refinance them. And we will continue to be in the market with 50, 60 billion of bond issues every year to finance our outstanding loans, because the average maturity on our bonds is around 7-8 years, while the lending to Greece is 32 years and to the other countries 20 years. So we are actually quite active in that area. But we also have to monitor what's happening in those 5 countries. We have a post-program surveillance function here. So Actually, we are quite busy, more than I ever thought, and therefore we are not urgently looking for more work. However, many other people do that. There is a debate in Europe and maybe beyond Europe how to strengthen further the institutional architecture of the monetary union. And quite often the ESM is mentioned to have the potential for further mandates. There are many ideas, nothing is decided, it's not clear what will happen. Some of these ideas are not mutually compatible, or they're exclusive actually. Like one idea, Andrea mentioned already, to have a euro area treasury is not really compatible with developing the ESM to a European monetary fund. That would really be a different function. These ideas are competing, they are around. So it's interesting to see that so many people have so many good ideas how we should work more. The European Monetary Fund comes up quite often. I think when the next crisis hit, and I don't expect that anytime soon, but we know our economic system has crises from time to time. So one day there will be another crisis, another ESM loan will be needed. And probably the instinct will be at that time not to ask the IMF to participate, but give the ESM a stronger role to do it within Europe. Maybe together with the Commission, but certainly a stronger role for the ESM. That's pretty much agreed. But that does not mean that we don't want the IMF now to conclude the last case of the old crisis. So I'm talking about the future. So I think that's pretty clear. Then to have a true European Monetary Fund where the ESM would do everything in Europe that the IMF also does globally, which would mean a lot of additional work on the preventive side with regular surveillance for all countries, that is something the European Commission does at the moment. To transfer that from the Commission to the ESM would require a change of the EU treaty. And that is a very complicated process, requires unanimous decisions, referenda in some countries. So that full move to a full European Monetary Fund in that sense, I don't see before my retirement, which is not so soon. But there could be interim steps in that direction, like I mentioned, when there's the next crisis.
Is it a good idea to transfer that responsibility to the ESM, to have it all organized in one spot?
Well, it depends what else happens. The European Commission is in charge of the EU, to all EU member states. ESM, of course, we have only the euro area countries as members and could take some responsibilities and competences that are really related to those countries only. Another example is the idea to have a separate budget for the euro area. The Commission obviously is in charge of the EU budget. To have a separate one, small one, fiscal capacity for the euro area, that could be managed by the ESM, for instance. But again, these are all ideas that are floating around, and it will be interesting to see the next few years what happens.
Yeah, absolutely. In the more immediate future, there's been talk of ESM issuing a dollar-denominated bond, correct? What's sort of the state of play on that?
That's right. So far, we have done all our bond issues in euro, because it's a lot easier. Also, our balance sheet is in euro, all our lending is in euro. We don't want to run currency risks. But now that we are becoming more mature and a bit larger, we always look how to broaden our investor base to have a reliable refinancing source for our lending activities. And we know that there are many institutions like pensions fund in the US or certain central banks in South America that never buy our Eurobonds because they only invest their money in dollar assets. So to tap them, that's why we are preparing a first non-euro issue. It will be in dollar. Will probably come in the last quarter of this year. We will hedge it, so we will not run currency risk, but we had to develop those IT things that are needed to do that. But we will be ready by the end of the year, and it will be another step to have a broader investor base.
When you're looking at developing a broader investor base, would that eventually involve issuing in other currencies, like maybe the sterling or the yen?
Absolutely. We have not decided what else to do, but legally we are authorized to also issue in other currencies than the euro. So we don't need any big discussion on that. That's part of our our instruments. And I actually would expect that one day we also do another currency, but I can't say today which one or when. It will depend on market conditions.
Okay, that absolutely makes sense. Now, sort of circling back to the broader picture in Europe, you were pretty optimistic about the European outlook in your remarks today. But what do you see as the major risks to Europe? When you look at European growth, where are the weak spots right now?
So first, I was not really optimistic. I was pointing to realistic numbers. And it's also important to see them in the broader context, because the headline growth looks low. And that is a problem for certain things, like when you look at debt dynamics. Also, certain producers, they don't care about GDP per capita growth, as I do. They look at the market growth. So always depends on what you want to do. But for policymakers, GDP per capita growth is, again, the same as in the United States. And I think that's good. Also not surprising, because in the end, when you take out the labor input, GDP per capita growth is determined by productivity gains, and that's determined by technological progress. And it's not surprising that mature economies like the US and Western Europe grow at the same speed, not every year, but on average over time. So in that sense, it's not optimistic. It's, I think, realistic. And there are risks, of course. I think in Europe at the moment, most of the risks are political. You know all the elections that are coming up. But here one has to be careful. Not every election that is a risk from a market perspective necessarily leads to something that is negative. We saw it in the Netherlands, for instance, where the outcome was fine and not in line with what some pessimists had expected, that the Euro populists would gain a larger share in parliament. They are well below 20%. Also in Austria, where a new president was elected at the end of last year, a very strong pro-European candidate won. In France, we will see on Sunday, of course, a very important election. There are tail risks that not reform-oriented persons might get to the second round, but these are tail risks. So I understand very well that markets have to price in these tail risks. But the overwhelming baseline scenario is that a pro-European, pro-reform-oriented president will be elected. So I'm looking forward to the results of these elections. And I think it could be the beginning of a stronger integration movement in Europe.
Now, I know we like to talk about these things as tail risks, but having just lived through the American election where everyone was convinced that Hillary Clinton was going to get elected, and then having lived through Brexit where everyone was convinced that Britain wouldn't be exiting the European Union, it seems like we need to give some credence to tail risks. So if we would see the far right dominate in France, what does that mean for the euro area? What does it mean for the future of European integration? You know, what do you see as the risks there?
Yeah, so that is a very small risk. I'm not saying it's zero. And that's why I understand that markets price it in. So not very likely to happen, but if it were to happen, for me it seems most likely that there would be a standstill. Because in the French legal framework, constitution, it's very difficult to take the country out of the EU or the euro area. It would require strong majorities in the parliament. So we know that a month after the president in France is elected, there will be elections for the French parliament. And it's, again, very, very unlikely that such an extreme president with such a view would get a majority in the parliament. So I think these very negative expectations about Europe and the euro would not materialize at all. But it would mean a standstill. The reforms that I think France needs and I think France is ready to take would be postponed again. And then growth would remain low. In a way, I sometimes compare it with Germany. It took Germany about 5 years to discuss what needed to be done in terms of reforms. The discussion started in the year 2000 when the Economist put on a cover page that Germany is the sick man of Europe. Most Germans had not realized it by then. And then a discussion started, and meanwhile the unemployment numbers went up and reached almost 5 million people in 2005. And then Chancellor Schröder put forward a very drastic reform agenda. And it worked very well. And today the unemployment numbers is 2.5 million instead of 5. And growth is strong in the European context. But there's no reason why France cannot do that also. Most people have forgotten that not so long ago, from 1995 to 2005, that's a 10-year period, every year France had 1% more growth than Germany. That's why Germany ended up as a sick man. They were not performing well. And it's not so difficult, at least for economists, to identify what needs to be done to shift the country to a higher growth path. In Germany, it took 5 years of discussion and a high unemployment number to get there. I think France has now discussed these kind of reforms for a number of years, so I think they are now ready to also to do it.
Okay, great. We should probably take some audience questions, although I have a lot left. I think we have mics coming around, so if you'll just wait for those.
Thank you very much. Dieter Detke, Georgetown University. Thank you very much for a superb discussion of the issues. My question is this. After Brexit, and Britain is a large economy, second largest in the European Union, one of the political consequences will be that the weight of the Mediterranean countries is going to increase. And the question for you, I guess, is, are you concerned about that? I mean, is structural reform at an end then, or what's going to happen? What's your concern if that materializes and once Brexit is implemented, Europe will look different, right? Thank you.
That's true. Europe will be different, and we will miss the UK because the EU will be smaller and the importance of the EU in the world will shrink politically. That's unfortunate. Economically, it will mainly be the cost for the UK, the long-term growth potential of the British economy will decline. We already see investment down significantly. FDI is drying up, not surprisingly, so this will have a negative impact in the long run. That's the economic side. This question of what kind of economic philosophy is predominant, I read that sometimes. I don't see that in my daily work. Positions are so different. Also, the EU changed the last 15 years. Northern Europe, Eastern Europe is much stronger today. We are now 28 at the moment. We'll go down to 27. Up to 2004, we were only 18 countries. Northern European countries that are also economically maybe in their philosophy closer to the UK, like Finland, Denmark, they only joined in 1995. So these things are always shifting, and I don't really see this will have a big impact. Where I see actually an advantage is that in the non-economic area, like more European common defense and foreign policy, we can do a lot more without the UK, because the UK was the one country that always vetoed progress in these areas, and I think that's a positive aspect.
In the back.
Thank you. Hello, Klaus.
Hi.
Good to see you. First, thank you for the presentation. It's remarkable what the ESM has accomplished in a very short period of time. And everyone likes to ask about the bailouts and the extensions of credit. I'm wondering if you could talk a little bit about the investment side of the ESM, which doesn't get as much attention. What do you like to invest in? I think it's probably going to become more important, particularly if the central banks continue to pull back on their own bond purchases at some point.
Yeah, no, I'm not talking much about it because it's not very exciting. So you're talking about the 80 billion euros that is paid in as capital into the ESM. This is there to as a guarantee for bondholders. So we are not using this money for our lending operations. We invested very conservatively. My 19 bosses, the 19 finance ministers of the euro area, they don't expect that we make big profits. They also don't want any losses. They don't want us to invest with a higher risk. So there are limitations around what we can do. We have very strict investment guidelines. Rating agencies look at that, rightly so, because this money is there to protect our bondholders. So we invest very conservatively, basically, in sovereign bonds, in bonds of international institutions, down to AA rated, AA minus. So all that is a very boring activity, actually. We are not doing any exciting investments. It would not be in line with our mandate. But there are challenges given this negative interest rate environment. So we always have to make sure not to make losses. We made profits in the past. We put them into reserves. So we could even for a while make some losses. But all this is within very strict guidelines and not very exciting. But some work.
Great. I should have mentioned at the beginning, if you could just identify yourself when you before you ask your question. Right here.
Hello, Petros Kasfigis from the Greek newspaper Eleftheros Tipos. Europeans want the IMF in the program, but the IMF is asking for more clarity on the medium-term debt relief measures and also lower primary surpluses. Do you expect any progress on the sideline of the spring meeting? And who is eventually to back down, do you think, the IMF or Europe?
Well, I don't think it's a question of backing down. As I tried to explain already in my statement, the IMF works with a different framework, which is quite all right, given its history and that they face a different environment in countries outside Europe. So I'm not criticizing this framework, but it's different from us. It's only up to 10 years. We are much longer. They have higher interest rates. So they have different procedures. You identified the problems that the disagreements that we have at the moment, but they existed in the past, and so far we have always found solutions. It means we have to do some work. I mentioned the mission that is going back. Of course, the time here in Washington is also used for some meetings. That's normal. We have the Eurogroup coming up on the 22nd of May. You talked about that, so we are working hard in order to come to an agreement.
Okay, over here.
Thank you very much. I'm Meg Lunsager at the Wilson Center, but I was on the IMF board for many years when we were approving these programs. And the question I always get from Congress comes back to the preferred creditor status of the IMF. And as you very well know, all the countries' quotas, what they give to the IMF, you know, whether it's used for lending, they count as their foreign exchange reserves. And basically, it's available on demand. That's not the same with the ESM, since it's coming from the budgets of the members. And so my question for you is how clearly can you state that the IMF does have the only preferred creditor status out there? It's very helpful for the US, for the other countries, when they're trying to seek broader support for the International Monetary Fund in their own political systems. Thank you.
No, there's a very easy answer on this point, because the ESM treaty, which is our legal base, ratified in all parliaments of our 19 member states, is very clear on this point. It may not be very clear on other points, but on this, it's absolutely clear. It says the ESM will claim preferred creditor status below the IMF. Absolutely clear, the relation with the IMF.
I think we have time for probably about two more questions. So back here.
Yeah. Hello, my name is Christian Hörbelt. I'm a student from Europa Universität Virginia, studying European studies. Germany is really benefiting from the European Union and the open market and is a strong man. And when we're talking about European integration, it's always the question what to do with this giant Germany in the middle. What do you think? Is the ESM the first step to become a transfer union? You talk a lot about solidarity, and as you pictured, it's working out really well. And is it no more possible after UK left? And would you prefer that?
So on your first point, I fully agree that Germany benefits from being a member of the EU and being a member of the euro area. But all the other members of the EU and euro also benefit from being a member. So I think they all benefit. And as far as transfers are concerned, the EU budget which is 1% of GDP of the European Union, is designed and has been designed since the beginning, since 1957, in a way that the richer countries finance transfers to poorer countries. And although the overall budget is only 1% of GDP, the poorer countries, which are typically also the smaller ones, they all get up to 3% of their respective GDP in annual transfers. This has been going on for a long time, for Greece, for instance, but also the Eastern European countries. For Ireland, until about 15 years ago, Ireland was a very poor country when they joined the EU. They used these transfers particularly well. They are now one of the richer countries. So the EU budget is the place where these transfers happen, and it was designed that way. And I don't see the need for monetary union purposes to have additional transfers. If the EU budget didn't exist, maybe it would be a different question, and maybe one would have really to think about it. But given that the EU budget is there to support poorer countries, I don't see that. So indirectly, of course, the operation of the ESM provides solidarity to countries that borrow from the ESM. But this does not lead to budgetary cost in Germany or any of the other euro area countries. It's an indirect subsidy coming from the capital that our member states give to us at the ESM. That's why we have a good rating, that's why we have low funding costs, and that's why we can charge Greece and the others a very low interest rate. And that is an implicit subsidy, but it's not what people call a transfer union, because there's no budgetary cost. You don't find any budget outlays in any of our member states with money flowing to the ESM and then to Greece. It's just not happening. There is no taxpayer money involved. Risks are taken by the budgets of our member states, but it's an indirect subsidies from which the borrowing countries benefit greatly. That's really the beauty of our setup, of our institutional setup, that we can provide these benefits without budgetary costs in the other countries.
Okay. Then in the back.
Thank you. Martin Wilhelm, Geopolis Energy Partners. My short question is it possible, you think, for the ESM to actually work too well, at least in the short run? What I mean by that is, as you pointed out, the biggest risks we're facing for European stability right now are probably political and have been for some time, if you look at the political situation in some key countries like France, Italy, etc. And one striking fact I find in the last few years has been the calmness of financial markets in the face of some of those political risks almost materializing. And of course, nobody can determine objectively how big the risk in France, for instance, is. They're very well-informed people like you who say it's quite low. They're very well-informed people in France who say it's actually quite high. So there's no way to know that. So my question is really by stabilizing financial markets, obviously you take away some feedback loop mechanism between what's going on politically in the public and political decision makers who have to eventually resolve the economic problems. Is it possible that may actually work too well for our own good?
Yeah. No, I understand your question, but my answer would be no. Of course, one very important objective after when the crisis broke was to stabilize markets, not only with the creation of the ESM, also by tightening financial market supervision, for instance, on Europe creating banking union with a common European supervisor. The unconventional monetary policy, first in the US and UK, but the last few years also in Europe, of course, helps a lot in stabilizing markets. So there are many factors that play on this, and some of them will come to an end in order not to stabilize markets too much. So I think it's not so much the question of the ESM really here. We are there for extreme situations. In a way, you could also say that the existence of the IMF, of course, takes away some tail risk. That's the idea. And it's not coincidence, I think, that also the IMF was created after a very, very big crisis, after the crisis of the 30s. Then there was a war, so it took a few years, but then it was, in a way, still a direct response to the crisis of the 30s, because most people thought it would make sense to avoid such a deep crisis, even if the existence of such an institution takes away some tail risk, and therefore lets market work maybe a little bit less volatile. But one also has to be very careful what markets do and can do and cannot do. We know there are frequent market failures. In Europe, it's very clear that until the autumn of 2009, when the crisis hit, there was a market failure because the spread on Greek 10-year government bonds was 30 basis points compared to Germany. And although we didn't know the full magnitude of the fiscal deficit at the time, it was already known that it was around 4%. And the new government was elected and they promised lots of expenditures. And still, the spread was very, very small compared to Germany. So I call that a market failure. And then during 2011-12, there was also a market failure because once the markets woke up to the risks, they reacted too strongly, as they often do. There was overshooting in the other direction, also market failure. So I think given that, the public sector has no choice but to put in some circuit breakers, and that's how I see the ESM in Europe and the IMF internationally.
All right, I think that's about all we have time for. I know you have another appointment.
Yes.
Thank you so much for taking the time to talk with us today. I think it was very insightful, interesting. I think I speak not only for myself, but everyone else. So thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.